What's going on, everyone? Welcome back. Today, we are continuing our player positional rankings as we have got our top 12 tight ends for this 2020 fantasy football season. We're going to talk projections. We're going to talk tiers. No worries there. But before we get into it, a quick reminder, check out the all new and updated website at alldaypigskin.com for some exclusive content, along with a place to order your 2020 ADP fantasy football draft guide. It's got everything you could possibly want at a great value. Top 150 overall player rankings, standard and PPR formats, along with individual player bios, tiers, projections. You also get general fantasy football advice, guys to target, guys to avoid. So really a great resource. All the details in the description. And as always, if you guys enjoy, hit that like button, subscribe. But for now, let's get right into it. Coming in at number one, and maybe to nobody's surprise, we have got tight end Travis Kelce of the Kansas City Chiefs. And we should mention quickly, this is more ranking-wise on a PPR basis, but honestly, even if it was a standard format, we would still have Travis Kelce at that number one spot. That's how consistent and dominant he is. Because when we're talking specifically PPR format again here, he continues to lead tight ends in two very important categories. This was the case last season, receptions and yardage. Last season, he had 97 receptions, almost got to that triple digit number, and over 1,200 receiving yards. The next closest tight end was Darren Waller, 90 receptions, 1,145 receiving yards. And when you consider that Patrick Mahomes was dinged up, not 100% for the majority of the season, kind of makes it that much more impressive. It shows that Travis Kelce, probably one of the most integral parts of that offense, no matter whether they bring in young wide receivers like a Mecole Hardman, or they've got emerging superstars like a Tyreek Hill, Travis Kelce continues to be that guy, that tight end that can be a wide receiver one, why he continues to be so important and so highly drafted. We anticipate another similar type of situation for him projection wise in 2020, right around that 90 to 95 reception number, then over 1,100 yards more than likely. Also, do expect some positive touchdown regression. He only had 5 receiving touchdowns in 2019. We think that number can get to 7 or 8. And anytime we're talking the Kansas City Chiefs offense with Patrick Mahomes under center, this is an offense that you're going to want to trust. And that's why Travis Kelce, even more so, is our number one tight end for this 2020 season. Coming in at number two, we have got George Kittle, who also rounds out our tier one group of tight ends. It's him and Travis Kelce. Last year, they finished respectively one and number two in tight end PPR scoring. And as you can see, we have got a similar type of projection for 2020. I know it might be a little bit chalky, but honestly, it's Kittle, Kelce, and then everybody else at the tight end position. There's a reason it's a premier tier one group of guys, only two names there. They're the closest thing to a wide receiver one, like we said. They're usually the best pass catchers on their team, most consistent, highest reception yardage, and touchdown ceilings. That's definitely the case for George Kittle, because he is the most dangerous pass catcher on the San Francisco offense. They are a run-first offense, but when it comes to passing and who Jimmy Garoppolo trusts the most, that is George Kittle by far. We have him going for right around 90 receptions and 1,050 yards, again, right around 7 touchdowns. Maybe a little bit conservative on the receiving yards, but since this 49ers offense is run first, that is the thinking there. But all in all, we believe Travis Kelce, George Kittle, there's a reason they're being drafted in the second and third round, not that far apart from each other. These are the two guys that are in a category by themselves. Next up at number three, we have got Darren Waller, who officially transitions us into our tier two group of tight ends, maybe a little bit higher on our PPR formats, but after his breakout season last year, it's tough to go ahead and ignore someone like Waller, who was only trailing Travis Kelce in the all-important reception and receiving yard category. He had 90 receptions for 1,145 yards last season. He basically was the offense for the Raiders. And I realize a lot of people will say, well, okay, the Raiders went ahead and added guys like Henry Ruggs in the first round. He's going to go ahead and immediately demand a higher volume and take away targets from Waller. And to some extent, that's true. But let's not forget after all, that Ruggs is still a rookie. Waller is the more experienced. He has more chemistry with Carr. So I don't think you're going to see that big of a drop-off, drastically speaking, as many people anticipate. Now, sure, Waller's not a tier one tight end. He's not in that elite category. But these tier two tight ends, they're still very integral to their respective offenses. And having one of these guys will still set you apart from the competition at that tight end slot. Currently, we have Waller for right around 85 receptions, between 80 and 85, and receiving yards right around 900. So a little bit of a dip in the receiving yards, but we still anticipate him to be one of the top pass-catching options for the Raiders and to also get a decent amount of receptions, catches on the year. Don't see that big of a drop-off coming there. For that reason, he should be a pretty viable tight end in PPR formats in 2020. Coming in at number four, we have got Zach Ertz of the Philadelphia Eagles. Another example of a much better PPR suited tight end. Zach Ertz is the top option pass catching wise on the Philadelphia Eagles. He usually, even in down years, somewhat similar to last season where he finished under 1,000 yards, still had a very high reception amount with 88 receptions, 916 yards receiving for 6 touchdowns. And a lot of people will point to the emergence of Dallas Goedert, and that is true. That's maybe a bit of a reason why we're not as high on Zach Ertz in standard formats, but he still does retain a lot of value in PPR scoring. He should get a lot of targets. Carson Wentz does prefer his tight ends. Zach Ertz for a while now has been the top pass catching option for the Eagles on a pass first type of team. We anticipate again between 80 and 85 receptions, probably right around 900 yards with 5 touchdowns. Maybe not as high of a ceiling as a Darren Waller because of all the weapons there, but we still think that he will be a tier 2 stable type of tight end for 2020. Next, number five, we have got Evan Ingram, definitely the most controversial name at this point in time in this category, considering some of the other tight ends that are still left on the board. But we are extremely high on Evan Ingram. Guys, before he got injured in 2019, Evan Ingram was on a crazy pace. Now, we realize that he missed a good portion of the season, only played 8 games, finished with 44 catches and 467 yards. But if you extrapolate that, he would have been on trajectory to finish with 88 receptions, which would have put him in the top 5 in terms of reception total for tight ends. And also, he would have finished with 934 yards receiving. That is a serious number. That would have put him, again, in 4th place in terms of receiving yards for tight ends. And that's why you see the incredible upside for Evan Ingram. Yes, there's an injury history there, and he is the riskiest name in this tier 2 group of tight ends. But his upside is also crazy high. Right now, he's probably being drafted outside of the tier 2 group of tight ends, but we see the upside. He literally creates mismatches every single time he lines up. He's so big, he's so physical. If he can stay on the field for the majority of the season for the Giants, he's going to have a great season. Daniel Jones is an underrated passer. He likes to air it out. A lot of pass attempts per game, and Evan Ingram is one of the more reliable pass catchers on this offense as a whole. So for that reason, we're high on him in 2020, and he currently presents pretty good value in upcoming 2020 drafts because some people might view him as a risk, but as it stands right now, we view him as a risk that is worth taking. Coming in at number six and rounding out our tier two group of tight ends, we have Mark Andrews, one of the blow up tight ends of last season. He was absolutely sensational. In standard formats, he was the number two tight end, bit of a drop off in PPR, the number five tight end. And people might be saying, blasphemy, how can you have him at the number six spot? Well, our worry with Mark Andrews, and do keep in mind, again, this is more PPR geared, is the reception total for one, because last season he had 852 yards, but he did that on 64 receptions, much lower than anyone in the top five in PPR scoring. The other tight ends had 97, 85, 90, and 88 receptions. So pretty much 20 less receptions for Mark Andrews. That is a big number. And the biggest concern probably is regression in receiving touchdowns, because last season, Andrews led all tight ends with 10 receiving touchdowns. That's a crazy high number. We know that the Baltimore offense likes to prioritize the tight ends, but receiving touchdowns usually fluctuate wildly year to year. And with the anticipated growth of someone like a Marquise Brown, it wouldn't be all that crazy to see that number dip for that Mark Andrews. For that reason, we have him here at number six. Next up at number seven, we've got Jack Doyle of the Indianapolis Colts. Kicking off our tier three group of tight ends, we are by far the most bullish on Jack Doyle this season in the tight end department compared to other analysts and other rankings, because there you probably going to see Jack Doyle usually outside the top 10, maybe even closer to that top 15 number. But we realize the upside for Jack Doyle here, and we love it. There's a reason why he's ranked as our highest tier three tight end. Sure, these guys are usually viewed as tight end number twos and might not be as consistent on a week-to-week basis, but one or two of them will surprise with higher than normal yardage and touchdown numbers and are usually on potent offenses. And Jack Doyle checks those boxes here. It's amazing what can happen when you bring in a new quarterback like a Philip Rivers. It's day and night type of difference between him and Jacoby Brissett. This entire offense becomes a threat now in the passing department. And we know the type of success that Rivers has with previous tight ends for the Chargers, Antonio Gates, Hunter Henry, and he usually relies on those guys pretty often. And with the departure of Eric Ebron, Jack Doyle will have a much higher volume. And if you think about it, him and T.Y. Hilton, probably the most experienced pass catchers on this offense. We really like the upside for Doyle, around 65 receptions for 800 yards, right around five touchdowns, maybe. That touchdown number could be the X factor here, but we are really high on Doyle heading into 2020. We love the environment. We love the quarterback. We love his involvement in the offense. He is an absolute steal at this point in time in all fantasy format drafts. At number eight, we have got Mike Gesicki of the Miami Dolphins, and Gesicki will be an interesting type of tight end. He was someone that came on late last season, finished at that number 12 spot in PPR scoring, had 51 receptions for 570 yards and five receiving touchdowns. In standard scoring at the number 11 tight end spot, so not that huge of a fluctuation, but we anticipate improvement for Gesicki almost across the board, because he became one of those favorite targets for Ryan Fitzpatrick as the season continued on, and with some more expected quarterback stability for the 2020 season, as we anticipate that the Dolphins will give Ryan Fitzpatrick the reins for this year before they turn it over to Tua. That will benefit every single pass catcher on this offense, including Mike Gesicki. And for an offense that right now their rushing attack maybe could still use some work, and the defense that's still coming up, they might be playing from behind a decent amount. So that will go ahead and precipitate a lot of passing opportunities. Gesicki will further benefit in that department. Now, this could be another type of X factor situation where the touchdowns become the most important category. Gesicki is that type of red zone threat that could excel here, similar to an Eric Ebron from a couple years back. At this point in time, we're being a little bit conservative with that touchdown number, though. We have him going for 60 receptions, right around 700 yards, and six touchdowns on the season. Should be good enough for a top 10 finish. Next up at number nine, we've got Tyler Higbee of the LA Rams. A lot of people have Higbee as a potential breakout, specifically in PPR formats. He was a pleasant surprise towards the end of the season last year. He had 69 receptions for 734 yards. And when you consider that the Rams had guys like Brandon Cooks, Robert Woods, Cooper Kupp, makes it that much more impressive. But the reason maybe we're a little bit more hesitant to go ahead and say, yes, Higbee will absolutely break out the season is because, well, the Rams still have another tight end in Gerald Everett that they like to go ahead and rely on. And when both those guys were healthy, they would kind of alternate with having big weeks from time to time. So for that reason, we're not quite as high on Higbee this year. We recognize that there's another question mark with the presence of Everett. Yes, the departure of Brandon Cooks does make some more targets available, but Josh Reynolds will go ahead and live up to some of that as well. We're also not quite maybe as high on a quarterback in Jared Goff as some other people might be, and in the Rams as a whole, the offensive line does present some issues. So for that reason, we have got him closer to that number 10 spot. Still, however, right around potentially 70 receptions, which would make him a very viable tight end again in PPR formats, could have a higher ceiling than most of these tier three tight ends because of that high reception count. So if you're looking for someone in this tier three category in PPR formats with that high reception possibility, Tyler Higbee could be your best bet for this year if you're willing to risk the presence of another tight end in Gerald Everett and an uncertainty in the Rams offense. At number 10, we've got Noah Fant of the Denver Broncos. And Fant, heading into his sophomore season, should definitely see an expanded role with the Broncos. And he should also improve on some of his stats from last season. He only had 40 receptions for 562 yards and 3 touchdowns in 2019. So it's not out of the realm of possibility to see him improve by around 10 receptions, maybe 100 yards this season. The true X factor here will be the touchdowns. A lot of people high on Fant is maybe the sophomore tight end to own in 2020. But let's also point out the question marks. The Denver Broncos offense is run first. They still have a young quarterback in Drew Lock that didn't play the entire year in 2019. So we don't really know what to expect from him with a full season in 2020 where he is projected to be the starter. The Denver offense did add someone like Jerry Jeudy who will immediately take some of those targets of Drew Lock's. So for all these reasons, there are some question marks still with Noah Fant. We do believe though, if he can go ahead and potentially get to 6-7 touchdowns on the season, be used as that red zone threat, that could be the X factor here where it puts him inside the top 10. Otherwise though, he could potentially be one of the bigger disappointments in this tier three group of tight ends and fall outside of the top 10. Next to number 11, we have got Rob Gronkowski. And Gronkowski is definitely the biggest name probably on this entire list, but let's not kid ourselves, he's not what he used to be. At this point in time, he is probably right where he should be in terms of a tier three tight end. And yes, him and Tom Brady have the most chemistry on this new look Bucs offense, but there's so many other weapons there for Tampa Bay. Mike Evans, Chris Godwin, you've got OJ Howard, you've got Cameron Brait. So honestly, Gronk might be the third best tight end on that offense, but his familiarity with Brady will go ahead and probably win out on some favoritism there. Now, we do favorably like that this Bucs offense expects to be pass heavy with a head coach like Bruce Arians. And Gronk will probably be a red zone target for Tom Brady, but his best days are behind him. We might even be a little bit optimistic with his projections. We currently have him for 60 receptions, 750 yards, and 4 touchdowns. Those receiving yards could very well be less, but they could potentially be counteracted by a higher touchdown number. So we believe that this is probably right around where Gronk should be viewed as, right around that 10th, 11th best tight end, especially in PPR formats for the 2020 season. And finally, coming in at number 12, we've got Hunter Henry of the LA Chargers. And this one is a little bit tough because we love Hunter Henry as far as the talent, but the situation is really unfortunate because with the departure of Phillip Rivers, the Chargers offense becomes one of the biggest question marks in the NFL and in an entire fantasy football landscape. Someone that was a surefire tier two type of tight end, Hunter Henry now becomes a questionable tier three tight end at best. Sure, the upside is there if Tyrod Taylor plays the entire season and there's quarterback stability, but there is a drop-off, especially in the passing yardage, passing volume going from Rivers to Tyrod Taylor, or even potentially Justin Herbert. That's why we can't rank Hunter Henry that high. He should still be involved as one of the top weapons on this Chargers offense, at least. You know, it'll be him, Keenan Allen, and Austin Eckler as the top pass catchers. But again, with all these question marks and with the different possibilities of a potential quarterback switch to Justin Herbert, we have him at the number 12 spot currently. So with that, we wrap up our look into our tight end rankings for this 2020 fantasy football season. And as always, let us hear it in the comment section. Do you agree, disagree? Is someone too high, too low? Are there guys that you think should be on this list that aren't, along with any other fantasy questions you guys might have? And another quick reminder, check out the all new website at alldaypigskin.com for some exclusive content, and also getting a copy of the 2020 ADP fantasy football draft guide to go ahead and see more rankings like these, more in-depth rankings specifically. Details in the description. If you guys enjoyed, hit that like button, subscribe, and we'll see you in future videos.